Good afternoon, friends. So the first thing I have to do is to apologize for my throat. I've been struggling this whole week to make sure and trying to not talk. And I've missed out on all the wonderful events that have been happening around the around town for the Mumbai Gallery weekend. And so if suddenly it goes into a squeak like it is now, I hope you're not going to get up and run away. It's just for a very short time. You are all, I hope you have all seen the exhibition. We are very privileged and lucky to have 13 of our 17 artists present today. We're also very privileged to have with us Dr. Jitendra Jain, who is, besides being a trustee of the Dr. Bhavraji Lad Museum, he's also, of course, as all of you know, the former very eminent and highly regarded director of the Crafts Museum in Delhi for 19 years, a museum that sadly, I mean, it just is in the most horrendous condition now. It's just sort of seems to have collapsed after he left. And it makes us wonder about what happens to institutions. It's not just about leadership, but I think the community needs to rise up and get involved and take a stand, because these are such precious institutions. He's been dean of the founding dean of the School of Art and Aesthetics at JNU. And of course, a very close friend. So we're very delighted to have Dr. Jain, who will talk to you about his engagement with textiles. And I just want to put to you and to park with you one of the reasons we decided to go to present an exhibition based on textiles. And I want to invoke the philosopher Bruno Latour. Of course, Bruno Latour is much better known for his work on the Anthropocene. He's a scientific philosopher that has deconstructed the nature of scientific theories and the kind of rational certainties with which our worldview, really, not just the Enlightenment, but also the modern worldview, has been constructed. And Latour questions this whole epistemological construction. And I think that's what many of our exhibitions, in fact, all our exhibitions try to do, is to question this nature of reality that has been handed to us. The idea of how we actually, how we accept received wisdom and how we, try to deconstruct it is a very important thing. And I think all our exhibitions, so I'm not going to just talk about the textile exhibition in particular, but just to give you kind of a larger idea of what we as an institution are trying to do. And I think one of the other things which was very important for us when we came to the idea of putting together this exhibition is the idea of these binaries of art and craft, personal, political, notions of femininity, notions of history, notions of politics, etc. And I want to leave you with a quote of Latour, which he says, "Facts remain robust only when they are supported by a common culture, by institutions that can be trusted, by a more or less reliable media." It means we have to say, and I think that's what we have tried to do as an institution and with our exhibitions, including this one, is to create that relationship with our audience and with all of you, is a relationship of trust, a relationship of questioning, a relationship of investigation. Thank you. And I'd like to, of course, I forgot also, sorry, to mention our two other panelists. our two other moderators, Abhay Sardesai, who is the editor of Art India, and again, a very well-known theorist and writer, and Arshia Lokhandwala, who is a well-known curator, has a terrific show on at the Bajaj Gallery, which just opened recently, and I'd recommend you all go and see it. The future is here. Yes, and may I please call on Dr. Jain to come and deliver his address.
Good afternoon, friends. Tasneem said that she's losing her voice. Metaphorically, and you will all agree with me that we must not allow this voice to die down. Because as you all know, there are difficulties. And when I say so many people here, artists and Bombayites, they must make sure that it doesn't happen. Tasneem had originally asked me that, oh, don't worry, it is just 10, 15 minutes. So till day before yesterday, I was prepared for 10, 15 minutes. But when I opened and saw the program, it came out that it was some kind of 45, 50 minutes. Time is not a question, but thing is that I had to put together things, which I have done. So you will have to see what I'm doing today in the light of that kind of assemblage that we have done. I have done. And from that, there would be. Fragments put together, which I will make sense of. Now, my lecture this evening spans cotton agriculture, the 17th and 18th century Indian cotton fabric exports. So I'm not talking about traditional Indian textiles like Calico Museum or Craft Museum and embroideries and ikats and those are traditional pre-colonial. I'm not talking about that. I'm not trying to bring the beauty of traditional Indian textiles and things. I'm more interested in what happened to the textile trade, manufactures, colonial period, the whole rise of visual culture that came along with marketing of Manchester and Glasgow textiles in India. Before that, when did handloom as aestheticized fabric that came after independence, khadi, its relevance, indigo, opium trade in Bombay, that whole money coming into the city, and what it was doing, the visual culture particularly related to, and therefore the title is Visual Culture of the Indo-British Textile Trade. What did that do to our, to India's modernity, fashion, and things which were not of that period, earlier pre-colonial. So some of those things, and then nationalism, Gandhi and textiles, Gandhi's aesthetics, Sarojini Naidu, Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, what were they doing with textiles and traditions and things like that? So I'm more concerned with last 150 years of history of Indian textiles. So in the, 17th and 18th century Indian cotton, I'll just quickly read this out. 18th century Indian cotton fabric export to Europe, Britain's Industrial Revolution, and the rise of mill-made fabrics, Indian cotton goods, and the global slave trade. How many of you know that the global slave trade had strong roots in Indian textiles? I'll come to it later on. But that Indian textiles exported to Britain, and then on certain ground they were not allowed to enter Britain, and these were directly from British ports or sent to Africa, to Ivory Coast, where slaves were exchanged. Because the British had fear of Indian color, the riotous color, and therefore it wasn't the taste. And there was another reason, that is to protect their own wool and silk industry in Britain. They then did not let Indian fabrics come into their country. So there are many such histories, but it is very direct relation of slavery and Indian textile that is much documented by anthropologists in the last 20 years. Then the political and aesthetics dimension of khadi and handloom, the Swadeshi movement, and the encounter with colonial Indian modernity, especially with regard to the development of the modern sari with its nationalist connotations. Yeah. So before the end of the 15th century, Indian cotton fabric was exported to Europe via the Arabian Sea. So Arabian traders were carrying via land route Indian textiles to Europe. Now what you see on top right, the black and white drawing is very interesting. It is a literal kind of illustration of a German word, Baumwolle, which is the word for cotton. So Baum meaning tree and Wolle is tree wool. And therefore the Germans thought till when cotton from India spread to their country, they thought that in India sheep were, they knew that it was a plant. And therefore they thought sheep were growing on the plant. And that's how, so until about that period, it was somehow, cotton was not known in Europe. So many such drawings and things about Baumwolle. Even today you go to a shop and you want to see the label where it's cotton, they say Baumwolle. So 100% Baumwolle or something like that. So this, and then here you see in this left one, a trade labor of Hilterman Brothers of Manchester. These two Arab traders are examining Indian fabric, and the crates are ready to be sent to the ships which are standing in the background. And then this kind of, Rally Brothers and thing, these are influences that were coming into India with regard to highly orientalized images of women, etc. And that's how some of the fashion that entered the country. The British East India Company, as early as in 1621, imported an estimated 50,000 pieces of cotton goods into Britain, whereas by 1766, cotton cloth constituted more than 75% of the East India Company's total exports, and most of it was from Bombay. So the rise of the city of Bombay, urbanization, is all related. We'll come to it. How many of us, so I mentioned to you about the slave trade, and the term used in British records for Indian textiles that went to Britain was rubbishy Indian cottons. So this rubbishy Indian cotton, meaning highly colorful, as I said, Europeans were very frightened of color. So there's a big fear of color. So for that reason, and then as I said, you can see this book called What Color is the Sacred by the Columbia University anthropologist Michael Taussig, very famous book, amazing account of about textiles and things like that, of India and export. And so as such, the Indian calicos were directly exported from UK to Africa, where the British merchants bought slaves in exchange of Indian textiles. This was in addition to, so this much was exported plus what went by Arab traders. Slave labor employed globally in cultivation and processing of cotton, coupled with the invention of cotton processing and weaving machinery during the Industrial Revolution, led to the colossal industrialized production of cotton cloth in Lancashire. Now you see on top, this John Bull is an imaginary character, always appeared in 19th century cartoons. So he's sort of suppressing the wool weavers whose industry was dying down, and on his right side there are imported cottons from India lying, and he's saying that, yes, it is certain that cotton is more useful to me than wool. Things. Below you see that picture, a spinning mule, Lancashire, that shows the scale on which things began to be produced. And what was the source of cotton that time for these mills? either American cotton, which was grown by through slave trade, or Indian cotton. But Indian cotton was considered low in quality, so the mills of Manchester did not use it as except when it was required when the American Civil War took place. So by 1880, 4,16,000 acres of global land was needed to cultivate cotton to feed the cotton mills of Lancashire. And ironically, India became the largest importer of British mill-made fabrics. So we were exporting cotton to Europe, and I mentioned to you the statistics earlier. But with the coming of these mills, Indian traditional Indian textiles, which were very labor intensive, which engaged women particularly, block printed material, embroidered, tie-dye, ikards, all sorts of traditional textiles were sort of copied cheaply in print. So ikat is not a print, it's a woven material. Tie and dye is a particular labor intensive embroidery. These were all printed and sent to India. And sorry to say that when the Calico Museum, Calico Mill, which started Calico Museum in Ahmedabad, even they are much after independence, cheaply produced cotton and cotton mixed nylon in which they produce ikards and tie and dye and lehrias, and all were done later on in line with the Lancashire thing. The story of one of the byproducts of the Indo-British cotton trade, the massive explosion of visual culture arising out of its fiercely competitive publicity campaign comprising the manufacturers and trading agencies, product labels and trademarks, calendars and advertisements, and its powerful and irreversible impact on the Indian society remains largely untold. So much of printed material that came from Britain to India. For example, you see over there. Now, you know, they began to use Hindu gods and goddesses on the labels. And I know that you go to, for example, Shekhawati, all the Havelis of Shekhawati, the Vaishnavs, as these were emptied, hundreds of framed mill labels of gods and goddesses came out with vermilion marks on that. So by that time, the rise of new technology, religion was undergoing transformation, and that Indians had become label worshippers and things, because each person could have his own god personally without going to the temple. So it changed the nature, and it democratized Hinduism, because they were mainly Hindu images. So it democratized Hinduism, that people were not allowed to enter temple, etc. They all began. And today, when you go to buy your vegetables, or you go to a restaurant, or buses, or trucks, or taxis, wherever, you see mass-produced Hindu images. So that mass production played a big role in changing the nature of worship. Unconsecrated gods began to be worshipped, whereas before that, in temples, the images were consecrated. So this brought a social and religious revolution that the printing did, and that was earlier part. For example, they would put a label like that to sort of emphasize family values. So the fabrics to be consumed, and the design that you see are all Indian designs. And this is, you know, in Calcutta, the dhotis were very important. Because in Kalighat painting, there are repeated references that the Bengali babus, even if he has nothing to eat at home, he would want his dhoti to be properly starched and the pleats to be hanging outside, shown or flaunted. So, you know, they used even such image on the cloth that came from Manchester, because this is like the pleats of dhoti are proverbial. In those who are Bengali would know this, Bengalis would know this. These less explored sources highlight the transformation of India's social and aesthetic values, its religious practices, and its modernizing and urbanizing aspirations. In short, the shaping of modern Indian society through it, through the popular visual culture. Because we are not living today our lives or dressing or our everyday life is not based on Mughal or Rajput painting or temple sculptures. Our lives today, the way we are rooted more in the colonial urbanity and this kind of exports and things like that, and exposure to that visual culture. This talk brings into focus the rise of the new visual field with which it proliferation of fashion and new identities and national sentiments were established. Besides price of the British mill-made goods, their strategy consisted of mass manufacturing through machine imitation of the laborious traditional Indian textile genres such as tie and dye, block printing, variety of woven and embroidered. The textile that you see here, they're all made in Manchester, in Lancashire mills. Or even religious textile like pishwais, Vaishnav pishwais, these were printed on large scale in Manchester. So even that sort of underwent a major change. Now in Bhavdaji Lad Museum, one of the rarest of the collections that they have are these Watson volumes of Indian textiles. And John Forbes Watson, he published two volumes known as Textile Manufactures and Costumes of the People of India. It was published by the Indian Museum in London in 1866. There was one India Museum in India House in London, which eventually merged with the South Kensington School of Design, which became then Victoria and Albert Museum. So now this was containing 700 original swatches, which I think Bhavdaji Lad is perhaps the only place in Bombay which has these volumes. It's amazing. And these are large volumes with original 700 actual swatches in there. Samples of Indian cloth material with full documentation of each piece was meant for boosting Lancashire cloth. So when these volumes are there, for example, when I just came to India after my studies and started to work for a museum, and I was in Ahmedabad, and I remember I was told by Gira Sarabhai, the really doyen of Indian museum maker, Calico Museum and things like that, she used to tell me, go and see Watson volumes, what is documentation? It wasn't available. Eventually, I found and I started to look. Yes, it was very good documentation, but nobody was that time reading what was behind that documentation. And I read four lines from Watson. India is in a position to become a magnificent customer, for to clothe but a mere percentage of such a vast population would double the looms of Lancashire. If we attempt to induce an individual or nation to become a customer, we endeavor to make the articles which we now which know to be liked and needed, and these were offered for sale. So actually the entire documentation was for replication cheaply, and that would destroy and did destroy most of the handmade textile industry until it was revived later on post Gandhi with the revival of hand loom through Government of India's. There were German exports to India, you know, Parsi garas and Parsi sari borders and things like that. So what you see here, for example, these are all made in Germany. For example, you can see outer cover of the swatches in which, and these are produced in Germany. Even these Vaishnav pishwais, which are crochet work that came from East Germany, mass manufactured and came to India thing. Even Hindu gods and goddesses, this was made in Eastern Germany, in Meissen and thing by certain companies who also were producing pictures like that were framed and consumed in terms of fashion and thing. So, and when these pictures came to India from London, again over that, some kind of additional spangle work, etc., was done. So there was a proliferation of visual culture along with the coming of commercially manufactured British textiles with German in India. American Civil War, the cotton boom, and the urbanization of Bombay. Very similar to this, Raza, the artist, had done a painting long back because he came from Amravati area in Madhya Pradesh, and there was a very big cotton market. And very early Raza painting, of which I have a print from somewhere, where he had done almost description of this kind figurative thing. So those who know Raza's later work wouldn't realize that it was such an important thing. Okay. During the American Civil War, 1861 to 65, the flourishing export of American King cotton, mainly exported to Great Britain, came to a halt and threatened to render idle the cotton processing, spinning, and weaving mills in Lancashire. Because of the war, cotton could not come from America to Lancashire. So the mills would have closed down, many people would have been unemployed, and millions of pounds worth of business would have lost. Britain started looking to India for massive imports of Indian cotton. Members of the various communities of Bombay, including wealthy merchants, bankers, brokers, traders, invested their all in cotton growing and export, and thought of no other business or commodity in the frenzy of the to huge profit from them. For example, cotton trading made the fortunes of Forbes and Company. There are many, the right side bottom label, for example, says Forbes and Campbell, etc. For example, cotton trading made the fortunes of Forbes and Company, Bombay-based, so much so that there was a time when the entire cotton crop of Gujarat was cornered by one company, because this was these four years in which money was to be earned. They were appointed bankers to the government of Bombay, and from there arose what is today the State Bank of India. Landmarks of Bombay, such as Rajabhai Tower, the Town Hall, the Royal Asiatic Society, the Turf Club, the Bombay Chamber of Commerce, some of the railway lines and reclamation projects owe their existence due to Forbes and Company. So imagine urbanization of Bombay, the money that came in, and the role that cotton was playing in the city, besides other social and religious changes that I mentioned to you. And there's a funny label over there. Here. So here, the British woman who came here with a bundle of cotton is going back in her boat, Bharat Mata. This is very nationalistic kind of thing. And then says, I'm here, the write-up here says, I'm not sold, India can spin better. So this was the kind of publicity visual material that was being generated. Rise of labeling, trademarking, and publicity of textile goods, use of Hindu religious imagery, and that of Royal British endorsements. Heavy industrialization of British textile manufacturers brought about massive production of cloth, generating competition among mills in Britain itself. And the rising indigenous production in India led to furious trademarking and marketing campaigns. The European mills and their agents in India began to paste attractive multi-chrome labels on the bales of textile exports to India, having images of Hindu deities endorsing their product. These labels boosted market of their cloth as they became collectibles and objects of domestic worship. This also democratized access to Hindu deities across the caste lines. The esteem of the British royalty was so high in the Indian mind that the labels having their portraits lent credibility to their products. This was something very important. For example, when I was doing some of my field work 25 years ago in some tribal areas, and I found tribal women wearing necklaces made of British coins, silver coins. So I asked them, why were they wearing these? So they said that when we go to silversmiths, they cheat us the proportion of silver that would be in the metal. But the British silver, standards of British silver coins were such that they were reliable. And therefore, there was this kind of credibility that was established what came from Britain, even right up to tribal area. So their portraits and things were also used. It was a kind of mark of credibility. Now, a little bit about indigo. As I said, I'll go a little bit of all I put together yesterday. Indigo, most coveted British trade commodity. Its forced cultivation and farmers' revolt, its synthesization and the dawn of chemical dyes. When competitively priced synthetic indigo was, you see, Bayer was a German chemist, and he in 1887 synthesized indigo. He worked for 10 years to find a formula. You see that formula below over there. That is chemical structure of indigo molecules as identified by Adolf von Bayer. And this was done over 10 years research, and next year he synthesized the red dye, the Indian second dye. So blue and red, these two dyes were very important in India because it brought to India, of course, East India Company, millions of pounds because it was supplied world over. So the story of indigo is very, very interesting. When I was doing some research on indigo 4 or 5 years ago in the British Library, and the librarian, when I talked to him, he brought me a file and gave me, and it was extremely beautifully handwritten, 25 pages, but in French, so I couldn't read. But then I found that some reader before me had put a piece of paper inside and had mentioned some kind of summary of that, in which he said that this was the paper that the French government had commissioned who were engaged in espionage of indigo growing and processing on East India Company. So this paper, then I was looking for translations, and I found eventually that it was this paper went to Bangladesh, and somebody in Bangladesh, in collaboration with a Dutchman, had published a small book and translated this, and that showed that French colonies in Africa had similar climate as in India, but the British wouldn't let the French, and they didn't have the know-how, because indigo processing is an extremely complicated process besides growing itself. So that whole thing was documented, and that is how indigo came to Africa through French plantations and things. When competitively priced synthetic indigo was first developed in Germany in 1897 by Badisch Anilinum Soda Fabric, that is BASF. You know these DVDs and CVD, these are all BASF, that is the same company. Anilinum Soda Fabric, based on the procedures developed by German scientist Adolf von Bayer, India was exporting 8 million kilograms of natural indigo annually. 8 million kilograms of natural indigo. So much of field would give you this much of indigo. During this period, 2,000 British indigo processing factories had come up in Bengal alone. 2,000 indigo. And this was a very, very laborious process, required a lot of water and labor. By 1830, 500,000 hectare in Bengal grew indigo and produced 4 million kilograms of indigo in a year, the value of which amounted to 24 lakh pounds sterling, 25 lakh pounds sterling, only Bengal indigo, Bihar separate. This market came crumbling down overnight after indigo was synthesized in Germany in the last decade of the 19th century. Shocking exploitation of indigo farmers led to the Blue Mutiny, as captured in the play Neel Darpan by Neel Bandhu Mitra in 1860. This was a very important play in every respect. Indigo even led to, finally, bringing of 1878 Dramatic Performances Control Act. So this censoring of dramatic, that act is still valid in India with when you change the law, you know, amendments, yeah. So many amendments this went through, but the law is still the 1876 Dramatic Performances Control Act is still in existence. How did it happen? So this market came crumbling down overnight after indigo was synthesized in Germany, etc. Yeah. Neel Darpan, the play was written directed by Bengal's most important theater director, Girish Chandra Ghosh, and there was a British priest in India, Reverend Long, who translated this play into English, he was charged under sedition and jailed forever. This English gentleman who translated for Girish Chandra the play. So. And this play was staged in Bengal, which created a big uproar. But when it was staged in Kanpur, that time when the scene came that the British planter was raping an indigo worker, I think the British got very upset, and that is how that 1878 Dramatic Performances Act was passed. So when that scene appeared on the stage. On the ill effect of indigo on the workers, the French traveler Tavernier, you must have heard his name, Tavernier recorded in the 18th century, he came to India and he saw indigo plantation thing and about indigo, and he writes, the workers who worked at this for 8 or 10 days would spit blue for some time after work. Because they had to, you see that photograph is a very rare photograph in the British Museum. And these indigo workers had to constantly mix with the sticks there. And this was a laborious and very, these people did not see beyond 30, 35 years. And their lungs would become blue. And the British officers, they were constantly working under the vigil of the British officers, that they don't waste time. The workers who worked at this for 8 or 10 days would spit blue for some time after work. An egg, unopened egg, placed near a person working in indigo vat would at the end of one day be found to be altogether blue inside. So this was the kind of, so we saw us talk about natural dyes, and we are very happy to have natural dyes. And I think we must know a little bit about what goes behind natural dye. And since so many of your artists have done work, I've seen some of them where I see such a lot of reflection of labor, social issues, things like that, women, gender, textile relationship, all this may have some kind of connection to that, what I'm saying now. These are also labels of this Badishani linen soda fabric. Nationalist clothing, the aesthetic turn. Now, between khadi, political khadi and aestheticized handloom. Gandhi's true vow of khadi was necessarily devoid of its aestheticization. He didn't want that you wear it because it's beautiful. However, a strong urge began to be felt to aestheticize khadi or opt for handloom even within the leadership of the Congress. To fulfill this aesthetic urge, while being politically correct, a wide variety of colored, printed, and decorated saris began to emerge. Vijayalakshmi Pandit is also recorded in her biography, is also recorded to have bemoaned the drabness of khadi and felt deprived when the women of the family persuaded her to wear it for her wedding. Because that time, even for wedding, it was important that Kamala Nehru was rebuked by her mother-in-law for simplicity of dress, which was considered inappropriate for a married woman. Sarojini Naidu wore rich Indian silk when she accompanied Gandhi to Buckingham Palace in 1931. She wore heavily embroidered, Sarojini Naidu, she donned rich Kanjivaram, Koligal, Karnad, Murshidabad, and Kashmiri silks more than Khadar. She even, in her biography, is recorded that she told Gandhi that when we go to for the round table conference, I'm not going to wear your horrible khadi, I'm going to wear my Kanjivarams. It is in her biography. Rukmini Devi Arundel and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, driven by the Indian aesthetic identity, put greater efforts in the traditional Indian sari genres, such as the brocade, jamdani, paithani, ikat, block print, tie-dye, in the handloom sector. So all what you get in the market is revived in handloom sector, and it is not comparable to pre-khadi era Kanjivarams and all that, because that was still all yarn was handspun. It was after the coming of mill spun yarn that the revival that has taken place of all this had. And Pupul Jaikar did the same with the establishment of Viva service centers across the country. Nationalist clothing, popular response. Now here you see. Now this sari, for example, here Vande Mataram is woven in the border. In this sari, Amar Desh, those who can read Bengali script can read, Amar Desh is woven in the sari. In this one, flag of India has been woven. Here the maps of India are woven in this. And when the Baluchari, Baluchari by the end of 19th century was going out, mills had closed down. These were really saris that carried British imagery, British sahibs and mem sahibs in buggies and things like that. As soon as these mills declined, and there was a very strong current of nationalism, because Swadeshi movement did not start with Gandhi. Many people have that mistake. Swadeshi was started already in Bengal in 1905. And Bankim Chandra, he wrote this song, Vande Mataram. That was a part of his novel in 1881 of Anand Mutt. So that was the fervor that time, that immediately when the mills closed down, not mills, but Baluchari, weaver stopped doing work. Baluchari was a town primarily established by the British with their silk mills. This whole change occurred that time. Dress dilemma for after independence. In 1922, when in jail, this is very interesting incident, when in jail, Nehru asked his father to send him 3 new dhotis and kurtas of a superior variety, because khadi was very coarse variety. Even though he was aware that the fineness of these dhotis consorted uneasily with the idea of khadi. So khadi idea was not to wear fine, it was to really suffer coarse material. The fine dhotis sent by Motilal to Jawaharlal were retained by him, saying, Kriplaniji used to wear a much finer dhoti than this. So finally he retained and he wanted to have it. So these are various dilemmas. National dress in the making. It is on record that both Rajendra Prasad and Rajagopalachari sought Nehru's advice on clothing for national events. So how national clothing developed, that Nehru would advise, and Nehru himself partly dressed like a Mughal emperor. How slowly national dress was developing. Young women in the employ of the government came to office as if giving a performance of Bharatanatyam. This was immediately after independence and women began to take jobs in government offices. This is recorded by Neeraj Chaudhary in his book called Culture in Vanity Bag. Later, Nehru issued a circular asking the men to be more careful in their dress and the women more simple, referring the use of jewelry in office, deferring the use of jewelry in office, and the length, or rather the shortness of the sleeves. So he commented on that, whether the sleeves should be in order and how women should appear in their office. Nehru recommended a buttoned up, but you know this bangala and things like that in government bureaucracy. A buttoned-up short coat and trousers. Nehru recommended buttoned-up short coat and trousers for his officers, declaring discarding European suit as a sign of snobbery. Officers looked like English butlers, hard to distinguish an officer from a waiter. So Neeraj Chaudhary is commenting on Nehru's development of bureaucratic dressing. Revival of tradition as modernity, which had both aesthetic and nationalist connections, led to several experimentations, including petticoat and accompanying blouse styles, because originally sari was never worn with petticoat, and then blouse wasn't worn. So when blouse and petticoat were added, and this had a lot to do with the imports of the visual culture that was coming into India, things like that, and many such thousands of these are in the market. In my collection, I have something like 1,500 of these folders and things where European women. In fact, I even came across an album where about maybe before independence, some textile dealers of Manchester were collecting these and making them into an album of European women, etc., as a kind of reference point for selling his thing for Western fashion. So revival of traditional modernity, which was aesthetic and nationalist connotation, led to several experimentation, including collared blouse, puffed or long frilled sleeves, or deeply plunged neck and back lines, etc., began to come, as you can see, things like that. And as the return journey of the magic carpet from Britain brought along with its cargo of textiles and piece goods, an array of images of exotic and amorous white women on their product labels, they in turn began to shape the social values of urban Indians in various ways. You can straight away see that some of this it got imbibed into sari or as dresses. Men began to dream up wives and mistresses in the image of a white woman. Women responded by sensualizing their attire and wearing short hairstyle. While so pleasing their men, they also relished the newly found freedom to allure and entice. Interestingly, Parsi sartorial aesthetic even appealed to Gandhi. He writes in his autobiography, that is about first decade of the 20th century in South Africa, this incident happened. That in order, these are Gandhi's words in his autobiography, My Experiments with Truth. That in order to look civilized, our dress and manners had, as far as possible, to approximate to the European standard. I therefore determined the style of dress for my wife and children. How could I like them to be known as Kathiawadi Baniyas? Because Gandhiji had gone to Africa wearing the turban and he was not allowed to practice law there. So Gandhiji says that, how could I, so there was a dressing dilemma. How could I like them to be known as Kathiawadi Baniyas? The Parsis used to be regarded as the most civilized people among Indians. These are Gandhi's words. And so, when the complete European style seemed to be unsuited, we adopted a Parsi style. Accordingly, my wife wore the Parsi sari and the boys the Parsi coat and trousers. So this, when I read this, since then, for 5 years, I searched for some visual, and I was lucky to find this one, that is Kasturba and children dressed as Parsis in South Africa. A battle caused by a woman's dress in Bombay. You know, when Lord Willingdon was the governor of Bombay, that time this happened, and Lady Alice Reading, in her her diary, which is published, she wrote about Rati Jinnah, who was the wife of Muhammad Ali Jinnah. War of wear between the between Lord Willingdon, Governor of Bombay, 1913 to 1918, and the Jinnahs. Rati Jinnah, cut to the waist, describes her dress. This Lady Alice, Lady Alice Reading is describing it. Cut to the waist, back and front, no sleeves, and over it a chiffon sari. She's extremely pretty, fascinating, terribly made up. All the men raved about her, the women sniffed. Now, what happened, there's an incident recorded that at Governor's Place in Bombay, Bombay's best of gentry was present, and there was a dinner, and Jinnahs came there. And as soon as Jinnah entered, whatever 15, 20 men there were in the hall, they all were looking at her or wanting to have access to her or engage with her or things. So Lady Willingdon was noticing it and continuously getting more and more. She was boiling with what was happening. At the end, when they all went to the table and sat down, that time Lady Willingdon couldn't control her anger, and she asked the bearer, Mrs. Jinnah is feeling cold, get her one of my shawls so that she could cover. And then Jinnah got up and said, if Mrs. Jinnah is feeling cold, she would say so. They both of them, without having dinner, got up and left. Willingdon was transferred out of Bombay after 6 or 8 months. So that what was happening in the dressing thing of Bombay. Maybe this is the last one. In the sari-clad Bharat Mata, a consent of sorts was achieved by dissolving regional styles of clothing into national style. So because there were so many regional styles of sari, but for constructing the image of Bharat Mata, it was all dissolved into one style, and that was that modern sari draping style, which I think in the government context was adopted by Air India hostesses. That was a real modernization of draping of sari, and that more or less then. Besides the Victorian moral value of covering the female body properly, Bharat Mata may have been clad sumptuously also to pervade the map with her presence and leave the disputed borders of India ambivalent. So when you do like this, then Pakistan becomes India if you do this. So, you know, your borders are sort of kept ambivalent. Women became the site on which tradition was debated and reformulated. I think I would end here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jain, for that absolutely amazing, fascinating lecture, which was just so richly and provocatively illustrated. You know, I think we'll keep the questions for the end after the interaction that we've had with the artists, with the moderator and the artists of this session. So let me, because we're running a little short of time, so can I ask Abhay and all the artists to, and Dr. Jain also, could you please come on stage?
Vic, thank you to all of you. Can you hear me? Okay. Thanks for coming, and we hope the interaction is exciting, and we managed to touch upon and raise some difficult questions, maybe enter areas of contestation. So the, you know, I mean, now that Dr. Jain has provided us with a very layered context to understand how this interplay of textiles and different landscapes, the national landscape or the urban landscape, have sort of transpired. I just want to sort of touch to begin with on this irony, you know. Irony as a trope which is getting regularly normalized now, that this is a city that has been built on the growth of textiles. And this is a space that has a long umbilical connection with the docks and the textile mills. The Bombay spinning and weaving mill that was started in, I think, 1856 is very close by. It was very close by in Tardev. And opium. Sorry, and opium, of course. And it's only in the 1860s that you had around 10 mills that sort of suddenly grew out of nowhere, mushroomed, and made the city into this extraordinarily important space. But cut to now, and you find that there has been this remarkable change. From a city of textiles, it has become a city that is basically a focus and nucleus of what one might call real estate. So, you know, if you actually follow the arc, you realize what I was talking about when I said that the presence of irony as a trope and the way in which it allows us different vectors to understand the transformations in history. I think it's something that I feel a lot of the people, a lot of the artists in this show have actually pursued in some capacity or the other. And it's very ironical, once again, that there is this constant fight that is happening between the powers that be, the powers that are, and all the people who are interested in preserving the history of the city, slices of the history, for a textile museum, which has still not actually fallen into place. In the way in which we actually want it to be. So I'm just trying to maybe start off by talking about the notion of what we might call a dynamic archive. And that seems to be something that almost all the artists have touched, explored in some capacity or the other. You know, in Manisha's case, of course, you have the shrine as the archive. You have the loom as a metaphor, the city as a textorium, an interactive work in progress with Sharmila, for example. You have the lives of laborers, objects, clothes being framed in Rakhi's works. Sorry? Yes, of course. absolutely, coding. And you have migration, memento mori, craft, art, kalamkari, pedagogy, and what it means to be exotic, and how the exotic is the new normal, as it were, in Lavanya's works. Oops. And you know, you have the scroll, the painting, and the idea of the document, you know, and the document as being composed by a flurry of registers, whether it's a poetic register or the visual register or the way in which this register sort of constantly have a conversation amongst themselves and transform the way in which we understand the positioning and production of knowledge in Nilima's works. So in Archana's works, of course, you have the city and the stratification that exists, stories and narratives as tentative memorials to a changing landscape. And in Manish, who is not here, unfortunately, is he around? No. Okay, so in Manish's works, you have, again, coming back to the idea of the textile city, you know, the idea of rags, which are then repurposed to create screens, to produce columns that look like what one might call gibbets, that look like scaffolds. You know, and I think the work, Manish's work, in fact, sort of, you know, comments in a very lacerating way on the way in which the city itself is slowly progressing towards what one might call a really dark nowhere land. So I think these are my opening comments, and I would really request all of you to respond to the idea of the city as an archive. And I start off with asking the curators, Tasneem and Pooja, about whether this was an idea that played on your mind even as you embarked on this particular show.
Thank you, Abhay. Yes, absolutely. As you mentioned, we have the John Forbes Watson collection, and that's probably the most famous of these textile archives. And we also have a very interesting collection, which is partly colonial, but it's also partly folk and kind of, I mean, it's more, it's representative of rural, some very beautiful Banarsi stuff. So yes, so the museum itself is an archive. But it was also the idea of, there are so many different kinds of histories, you know, that are tied into these archives that we talk about. You know, it's not just one John Forbes Watson. If you take each of those textiles, each of those textiles represents such a deep and interesting history. The story of each one of those, there were these extraordinary saris, which were cut up by John Forbes Watson, who was the curator for several of the international exhibitions and also the director of the India Museum in London in the 1850s and 1860s. And so it was how, you know, the idea of that archive as well. And so I think, of course, the archive was one part of it, but it was, what was interesting is also, and the reason we engaged with textiles in particular is because it's just, it has so many dimensions to it. It speaks, as we will see in the exhibition, it addresses the idea of body, the idea of identity. You know, the issues of identity have again been a very important trope for us through all our exhibitions, because this museum itself questions this whole construction of identity, and that has been very important as well. So, and I think textiles have a very very important way of addressing that. Pooja.
Yeah, I think it's quite interesting that you speak about the archive, because of course, like Ms. Mehta said, the museum of course has a very strong city focus, and which is why we have, even in the exhibition, we've put out the medal that, you know, was given to the government of Bombay for the production and export of raw bales of cotton. We put out a picture of Cotton Green and the John Forbes Watson collection. And I think the idea for the show was also to kind of create. Yes, absolutely, yeah. Was also to kind of create an archive about, you know, the conversations around textile. So I guess it's not really a like what you would imagine as a textile show, because what we've done is brought very diverse practices that the conversations that arise out of a historical context or a cultural context that is so related to textile histories, to personal histories and national histories. So I think, like, for instance, in Paula's work, you know, it is about a personal history, but also talking about national borders, migration, cultures that transcend these borders. So I think it's kind of, you know, bringing all these kind of ideas together, but through textile, like we are talking about this. That was what we were thinking, I think.
I've already spoken much, so I'll just. You talked about Watson and some of the works I've seen. I think archives, in terms of quantity, that you have many things in one archive. That's one aspect. But what Watson thing tells us, and what I said was that archive has an underlying layer of ideology. And that, I think, artists have, in a way, all of them have, whatever works I have seen, that it's not what is seen. What is seen in Watson are beautiful samples, 700. But within that, as I read out, there was an ideological layer. And that's what I feel the brilliant works that I've seen here, some of, maybe I've left out a few, but I will see them now. But I've been seeing all your works upstairs. All your works in general. I feel that all of you are obviously not on the surface. So beneath the surface, there are other messages coming out from those works. And that is what is also Watson's archive, you know, I said. And I think we have to learn to, I don't want to be didactic. What I'm saying is that we want to be aware of such undercurrents, things which are lying. Otherwise, archive is just quantitative.
So, I mean, the works that I have put up here, one is fairly old, where the textile is, of course, just, you know, a way of putting together what was happening in the city, which was about how the city changed, how after liberalization, what were the effects of that on to the artist or the citizen of Bombay. And being from Bombay, one cannot go away, and with the history that I have personally, I cannot be away from the textile mills and the labor. And I guess, hence, textile has been one of the predominant motifs in many of my works. So whether it is just seen as a sari, or it is the loom itself. I mean, when you look at the work which is here, which is Bombay Weaves, it is not just talking about textile, it's talking about the making or the social fabric of the city, which is being rented, and how we are using, I'm using the Tanabana of Kabir, or the coming together of communities, and also the Heideggerian kind of idea of worlding, where, you know, I'm looking at the warp as the land and the sky, and I'm looking at the communities and the religion as, you know, which are represented by the looms as divinity and the mortality or the mortals. So, I mean, yeah, I don't think I need to elaborate more.
So the work that I've put up here is essentially, I was at that time looking at what is the life of a found object and scavenged object, if one has a way to make another world out of objects that you see around you. The work has a certain kind of foliage within quilting method, and that foliage material is essentially scavenged from Chinese mills, and it's a translucent fabric that you see in many parts of Indian cities as well as curtain fabric. And then it's also layered with a lot of fabrics that are scavenged from the city, from the streets, like construction sites that have been abandoned, and also used fabrics that I have had over a period of time. So it's a layered, it's a quilting process that has accommodated all of it. And the work was very specific to a context, and it was made for a public museum in China. So I was kind of looking at what could be ways through which you can re-experience the large field of fabrics, but also like as a phenomenological experience, how do you create a public space within a museum space? So the scale then mattered, because it was about what, how do we frame the public yet again. So yeah, the work had these elements in it. This is one specific work, so I was exploring it over a period of time with regard to these ideas. Yeah.
If I think of textile archive, I think mother's wardrobe become the immediate one at home. And with it comes the element of recycling, because often textile gets, you know, spoilt or ages, and you take parts of it and recycle it into something more personal and beautiful. And I think the set of boxes I've made, I call them enshrined. I'm thinking of home shrine, whereas I'm thinking of sacred as an idea, but in a more private space, a corner of the house which becomes a corner of confession or an invisible conversation you are having with somebody, anybody, a beloved or whatever. And that space becomes so precious to you, yourself, to oneself, that you want to adorn it, and you adorn it with bits and pieces of your favorite textile or fabric and beautify it, and it becomes a kind of repetitive act of making it more and more, just adding it on to make, adding a bit of yourself to it to make it more charged with the faith you have in that space. I think that's where the work came from. It was born out of a visit to Sri Lanka in Anuradhapura and Varanasi, both very sacred religious spaces. But what I was drawn towards was this absolutely absolutely sensuous fruits and flowers which were offered. I mean, forgive me for saying, they were totally sexy. And to me, that was the part which drew me in to say that that is what, I mean, for me, charged that space, which was the sensuality of that site, and came back and thought about sacred as an idea and brought it down to a public, a private space of my own.
This particular set of works of mine deal with another kind of archiving. It's in some sense not directly about textile, not directly about a particular kind of craft, but it is about, you know, I was trying to look for some continuities in the figurative painting or visual tradition in Kashmir. And I came across this manuscript, which was, as manuscripts all over North India at least, was commissioned by the British to make the, portray the everyday life and professions of the working people. And this for me became a catalyst in the sense that it started, for one, there was a difference. It was a cursive hand. It was not an academic hand which was attempting to emulate the imperial prototypes and things that would have been otherwise a kind of source. Now, into this, I had to put my, how does one put one's own, how does one put these continuities into it? Because There was, I mean, even today, this, how should I put it, this manuscript was in some sense an archive of what is there today. I mean, the same professions, the same tools, the same implements, the similar designs are all, there is a continuity. And so onto that, I tried to layer my own interest in what textile can do. What I was interested in, the palimpsest aspect of this, of layering it with resources from textile or from the repetitive aspect of textile, of printing and weaving. And with that, it was to bring a kind of the repetitive activity of labor, which then, I don't know, I'm just trying to throw these things together, that of the repetitive aspect of textile forms and of the laboring hand.
Dr. Jain's Bharat Mata story is always my favorite, when the sari goes and you grab the land. It was a privilege once to go to Oshiwara shop with Dr. Jain and to understand these textile labels. So Bombay as an archive is like every corner, I think. So it's just not textile, it's about everything. You cannot just separate textile. It's very difficult to separate textile, you know. Within the textile, everything comes in as a metaphor. So for me, even if I see Bangalore as a city, or Bombay as a city, Calcutta as a city, wherever I am associated with, it's the land is the textile. So the stories, the race, it is not too much about religion when it comes to labor class in the textile working. But it is about race. So many times I have seen there is a kind of level of race which talks about the economy, all those kind of color, you know, becomes very important. And of course about the empty spaces or filled up spaces or the nostalgia. Even in Bangalore, lots of mill lands, same is that nostalgia of the space, and you start imagining there could be something happening in like last few years or something like that. But so many times that villages which has still a small scale textile industry still remains. It is not so much around, not in the city, but around the suburbs, still not, it still functions in some or another way. And because their budget or their expectation is kind of that. So as I always work on oral stories and not debating too much on authenticity, it is left to you how much you believe me. But so I have dug lot of such stories in the city, talking to people and talking to, and so many times when I have done these block prints, which you see, and the block maker and the printer has always asked me, are you doing a social work? Or is it, you know, it's kind of, because they don't believe it's a story of them. So I am telling a story by narrating, by actually taking their story and narrating, then they distance and said, maybe it's not about us, you know, it's about somebody else. So that kind of distancing and then creating and interests me a lot. So for me, of course, in Chor Bazaar, I always say is the world's biggest archive we have. You find every nook and corner, everything there if you want to really search for. And Bombay, popular culture is like, so even in the saris and all, like if you are talking about in the independence time or after independence, the kind of imagery actually is very horrific. After
50 years when we talk about today, it's Modi in the sari. So it's kind of how imagery, but that national figures would come into, I think, that becomes an archive by itself if somebody looks at. You like it or dislike it. So that's my work.
Well, I think I've used and engaged with the archive in the more traditional sense of the word. Much of my work actually draws upon the history of much of the history that actually Jyothi Jain saw to talk to us today. And so these particular works, actually, I was thinking about education, really. And so I use natural dye. Actually, I learned kalamkari. So I use kalamkari. So I was thinking about education, what it means for an English-educated person to use something that is supposedly traditional. And so these works come from that. And like Jyothindra Jain sir said, our lives are still rooted in colonial urbanity. It's not like we're living, you know, outside of it, you know. So even though, I mean, we are not colonized anymore, English is very much part of our language. And with acquiring a language, you also acquire the culture of that language. And so in these works in particular, I've tried to kind of, so the history of kalamkari chins actually, patterns were sent from the West, wherever. It could be France, it could be England, and it could be, I mean, there were Jesuit kalamkaris. And these patterns were recreated by traditional artisans. And they wanted them to recreate it in their own fashion, which means to exotify it, to have an Indian touch to it, or whatever, to exotify it. So my works are actually very Western. It draws upon, so I'm using a medium that is traditional, but the language is very Western, which is actually the language of us today, the urban language. So yeah.
Thank you so much. Sort of to just sort of extend, you know, all the various trends that have emerged in the course of this conversation and tie them up in some kind of an interesting knot. I mean, I just feel that, and of course, all art is engaged in this process, but one strain that one observes again and again, work after work, is this penchant, is this desire to memorialize. And it's a very interesting sort of vista, because you find that there is this, and within or under the rubric of memorialization are all these different points. You have, in the case of some works, a lament for a lost cosmopolitanism, for example. You have a very sort of interesting mix of personal history, political history, national history. You have a desire to constantly tease out strains of nostalgia, for example. You have a deeply felt need to understand the life of a scavenged object, for instance. You have Kashmir. You have fading figures of laborers, citizens, the presence of death, you know, in somebody like Anita's work. You have the Julaha. So I'm just wondering about this desire to sort of to understand the past and to understand it in terms that are comparative constantly. You know, where you're looking at the past and the present and you're trying to come up with different scales, different echoes, and then trying to translate these experiences into terms that are visual, you know? So is that something that Dr. Jain would like to maybe respond to? And then we can, again. One more tedious round.
They came to town from Juhu and passed some of the mill areas. And a thought came to my mind, and I think that has come to see the exhibition. exhibition.
Hello?
Yeah. So I was thinking, and I heard from Tasneem and others, that there's a proposal in Bombay to use one of the mills, like former mills, to turn into a museum.
Yes.
And they say it would be a textile museum. Textile museum. I hope the city does not make a mistake of again making one more calico museum, in the sense these were our great tradition, and they are, of course, if you want to do a section of that. But I think what is awaited, and particularly if there's a museum to be done in the mill premises, I went there when Charles Correa was alive, and this proposal had come up, and
yes.
I was on the committee and went to see one of the mills, and I was amazed to see on the walls mill workers, their names were written, somebody had pasted their god over there, some colors were somebody's hand impression was there, somebody, all these remnants with which the walls were filled, the mill workers who used to work. Yes, also there were these pegs on which they used to hang their clothes when they came to work. They worked in undershirts, you know. All that one could see over there, these remnants, I thought, are extremely important. These, for my feeling, directly connect with some of you who are working in terms with textile, in terms of labor, in terms of bodily engagement, the contiguity between the work produced and the worker, or things like that. I thought, and then all what I mentioned here, the textile histories, the histories of exploitation, indigo, body, poison, a lot of those things, you know, and rise of the city. I hope there would be large, because mill premises would be that place, you know, where this, all what I showed now, but in expanded scale, plus, I think the work that is being, there should be a space where contemporary, modern and contemporary artists who are working with textiles, and why only textiles? Textile leads to other issues of labor, other issues of exploitation, other issues of individual predicaments, suffering, many things. So expanded like that, if a portion of that can be brought in, besides, of course, rise of Bombay city and urbanization, all, I think it would be a very, very unique place. You can have a gallery of traditional Indian textile, you could have a large thing about textile mills and the rise of Bombay city, but also a space where, because curators cannot do what artists can do, in the sense that, you know, artists are able to transform something in an abstract manner, and that is very much more powerful, you know. So maybe there's a space like even Baudaji, which is not a museum meant for that, but now that it is being used, you know, everyone is interested. You know, how the space is converted into something else. That, I think, would bring what you said just now all together, and we will be able to do something very unique.
Well, I think it's interesting that you're talking about historicizing and this kind of memorializing, like you said, and using the past. So one is, I think, what better place to do it than the museum, because we have all objects that talk about history. I also think that the past is actually not really the past, because it's always comparative, right? Like, I mean, it changes depending on where you're standing. It's always used politically, socially, to kind of give weight to things in the present. Or if you think about the city, like you said, even the statues that are coming up, the political statues, it's all kind of, you know, the past kind of, what do you say, assert some kind of idea, or, you know. So I think that we can never really get away from that. It's how we sort of find different associations and relevance. And also, I think it has to some extent shaped, actually not to some extent, to a great extent, who we are, what we are, finds relevance, or like facts or stories in the past. So I think that's what as curators, we were trying to do to kind of, you know, highlight those connections also. Yeah.
So I think both Dr. Jain and Pooja have really covered quite a lot of what I also wanted to say, but that's what I said at the beginning as well, that you look at these constructed histories, this received wisdom, and it is very important. It's not just a comparative. I think that I would not make that binary again. I would just say that it is about unpacking, about peeling, but gradually peeling away these layers and trying to understand them in terms of new ways, new modes of thinking, and new information that comes and that is revealed to us. And I think that's what really most of our exhibitions have been trying to do. And this one in particular, I think, just works so powerfully in this space precisely because of that history of the city intersecting with the history of the museum. And as you rightly say, so many of the patrons, the people, Gigi Boy, who was so involved with the building of the museum, Gigi Boy paid for the curator to go to London and purchase lots of objects for the museum, besides, of course, making a major donation. So many of those histories which we need to sort of unpack, understand, look at, as Dr. Jain said, the ideological construction, the ideological architecture of all of this. And I think that's what's so wonderful with each of the works of the artists, is that we've been able to address this very complex history, and each one of the artists has done it in a very unique, sort of obviously personal, but also it has a kind of much larger, it goes far beyond the personal. I wouldn't say that it is a comparative at all. I think it is very much about unpacking these histories.
Yeah, so, well, when we look at the past or at any archive, we look at it from the vantage point of now. That is why certain archives become important at certain times. It's because of the contingency of that time. And I guess works that you see here are precisely because of the moment that we are going through politically or socially within our reality now. And that is why these kind of archives suddenly become so important. The other thing is that when we are looking at how we make work, which is also something that the city teaches us, working in Bombay is a collaborative experience. And that is something, even the work that I'm having here is a collaboration. It's a weaver from Cheramangala, the place where Muziris used to be. This work was something that I actually started at Kochi because I wanted to bring in something from Muziris into the main kind of where the Biennale was held. This was, of course, in Jewtown. And the fact of what is happening currently with the floods in Kochi is the reason why this work becomes more poignant to be brought here. So, yeah, I don't think that an archive necessarily can be vitalized unless it is looked at from the now, because you want something in the future to change. So I think that is the continuity of even textile. And that is why the works kind of get layered within the way the artist thinks.
Of course, as what Eliot would call the pastness of the past and its presence.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Thanks. Even like continuing what we've been talking, I was interested in how one can translate these aspects of the past into a present and translate it into an experience in a way. So I used, in this work specifically, I used certain certain found sound footage, and I restructured it. And then I was also interested in looking at the metaphor of water, the repetitive dripping quality of water. So both of these have a capacity to create certain ephemeral experience, but at the same time a continuity is generated. So it kind of transverses into past as well as present constantly, you know, just the immediate past that has gone by, and but then you're living through that in a way. So I layered these aspects into the work through the process of repetitive hand stitching in the quilting process, and in a way it was all lived moment, you know. The process was just about that in a way. All the materials used, the labor that went into it, it was all about the lived moment in a way. Yeah, so I was in a way producing something from the past but making it very much about the present, yeah, in terms of experience, yeah.
Just to continue with where I started when I spoke last is, I think recycling comes very closely associated with textile and how you salvage that and salvage what you have, something of the past, into, I mean, Priya is not amongst us, but her life has gone into investing into rafugars, and these are invisible karigars who have revived histories. And this is so closely related to something materially palpable in textile. I mean, it's a moment I want to remember Priya, because I learned so much from her in conversation about salvaging something. And I think she literally did it spiritually with her own self in that manner and self. So I think I think textile becomes almost like a living body, whether it's past to present to now it'll go to future. I think it's like a continuous train of process which we cannot run away from. And it's a completely a living being in that sense. And it's also such a moment of desire, I feel. When I look at textile, I can't stop. And I think it's the case with many of us. It's the most tactile, something which you can't help but feel.
I'd like to actually put a question rather than to try to say something. And this is connects, it's something that has been in my mind because over the years I've been working in Kashmir or with ideas that come out of Kashmir. And, you know, one knows that in some ways the craft traditions, and especially the textile craft traditions of Kashmir, continued in a way to support the economy of the land, and it's also kept alive the certain hand skills, the kind of aesthetic of the region, despite the fact that the land is so traumatized and it's so difficult. But then, very often in my mind, there is the question comes the other way around. That is it because it is so traumatized? Is it because there are such few opportunities for other kinds of development activities that? Yes. Is that what nurtures tradition? Is it that the sons of Kashmiri craftspeople don't have other opportunities? Is that what the richness of the tradition is about? I mean, this is a very vexed question, so I would just like to put it.
Very difficult to speak after this. But I agree with Manisha. It also was like thinking of Priya a lot about the invisible art which she talks about. And that is, again, what textile or everything comes into that. And also I was like visualizing like when Dr. Jain was talking about that whole wall, which talks about identity and every kind of thing, which is already archived. We don't need to work more than that. But from there to that future, what you're questioning, that transition would be interesting to see as a, just not a static kind of thing, but then that would be interesting enough to debate also, how do you actually go into that zone of future? We just stand by the present in a way, but what it would be from there to where it will lead. So can there be a visualization of it? If like 20 years back also they spoke about what will happen in 2015, which has not happened, like that film, one of the film shows what would happen in 2015 in 1995, but actually that has not happened. But whatever the visualization of the creative process was, so it didn't go so fast in a way. But then how do we look at that transition? Can we really visualize it? Would be, I think, interesting.
I think rather than memorializing, I have looked at my project more as adding to, you know, I don't know if it's adding to the archive perhaps, you know, rather than thinking of it as something that is a memory, something that is past. It's something that can be pushed forward in many different ways. So one of the things that I experienced, like when I went to Kalahasti the first couple of times, I just finished my master's in painting. And they were very enamored, the artisans were very enamored by the fact that I could draw a human body. And they wanted to learn to do that. And so, but yet, of course, you know, they were Kalamkari artists and they couldn't leave their profession and come and do something else. So they had this imagination that perhaps the next generation would be known as artists rather than Kalamkari. So this thing about art and craft is always there. It's always there. So my project really has been, and another thing that interested me was they really didn't know about the history of chins or the history of Kalamkari, because Kalamkari was already modern. In a sense, it was revived by Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, but it had died out. So they only knew what they were taught by like one person in that village. It wasn't like a, there was no continuum really. And so I feel that kind of didn't really help in a way, you know. So I was hoping that, and recently also there was a Dastakar had organized something where the artisan and the artists come together. So I was talking to a Kalamkari artist, craftsman, master craftsman, and he had only recently seen the Calico Museum and the collection of the Calico or the V&A collection. Okay, and he is a master craftsman awarded by the government of India. So I feel my project is really adding to, you know, and I hope at some point I'll be able to show them all my work, you know, and show them a way in that technique itself, how you can push forward in a way.
Sure. So weaving memories and constructing critiques, I think two interesting areas on the horns of which a lot of contemporary art actually sits. I think time for us to invite Arshia and a host of other important, interesting artists who will probably... Sorry? No, no break. Take the conversation forward. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So we'll just proceed with the second session. And I'm going to ask Dr. Arshia Lokhandwala, who's the moderator, to start.
Hi. Can you hear me? Yeah. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. And our panel is Material Memory and Identity. I like to welcome Anita Dubey, Anju Doria, Shakuntala Kulkarni, Paula Sengupta, Pushpamala N, and Reena Saini Kalat. And one of the comments that actually Anita coming from Kerala talked that we are like all dressed as Sabarimala, you know, the black, you know, the textile or the color that we have over here. I'm also, firstly, congratulations Tasneem and Pooja for the show. I think the proximity of the museum to the mills and what also, you know, was spoken earlier about how the changes and the shifts that are taking place in terms of buildings and, you know, the whole transformation of the mills to these large, big apartment buildings is also very important to kind of to note at this particular point. I'd like to also draw attention to something very important here. We have, you know, a strong feminist kind of undertone in the show, and for many years I always thought whether women and, you know, the idea of textiles, it's always considered that, oh my God, it's a woman's craft, and do women naturally kind of weave and, you know, use textiles as part of their work, which is something that I hope that we'd explore. But I'd like to actually begin by inviting each of the artists, because they're using extraordinary material to kind of reflect their practice. And I'd like to begin with Anita Dubey, who uses velvet, and if we could start from then onwards and kind of unpack this backwards and come back to the curators at the end, if that's okay. Thank you.
Before I say anything about my work, I mean, isn't it interesting that most of the artists in this show are women? So this is so fascinating that the minute you have textiles, it gets associated with women, and the fact that there are no male artists who are actually dealing with this material. So that's fascinating to start with. It's really, there's Manish and? Okay, so but in a general way, yeah? That, immediately you have women as people who are sort of, you know, taking up the cause of textiles. Of course, they have to be. They have to be. Regarding my work, I mean, there are so many reasons why I started to use fabric. It was not premeditated. It's just that I was doing wood carving for a long time, and I had reached a point where I was no longer enjoying the process. So there was a hiatus of about a year when I hardly made any work. And then by chance, I thought, let me pick up some fabric, let me look at it. And when I went to the market, the only fabric that really attracted me was this velvet thing, because for all its strange qualities, you know, for the fact that it has more body than any other fabric has, the fact that its surface is a little hairy, which is, you know, which is closer to the way we understand skin. So all these things, and the fact that it's such a luscious thing, yet it's also a poor man's idea of richness, you know, because it, at I think 60 or 70 rupees a meter, it's not a very expensive fabric. And I, and also my association with a lot of Muslim friends, I know that, you know, velvet cushions were something that Muslim households had. So it's a very interesting thing. All these factors, in a very peculiar way, I liked, and it's just going with that kind of attraction towards that fabric. I got it and I started to use it. But going back to what was said in the earlier panel, I'd like to say that, you know, craft is a very important thing, at least in my practice. You know, I have a lot of regard for it and a lot of love for things that are made by hand, beautifully made, with exquisite skill, basically. So all these things, I have a deep regard for. I regard labor that is able to have that kind of not only skill but tremendous aesthetic sense. So and even beauty, I mean, all these things are very important for me. But of course the question lies that as a contemporary artist, what do you do with all your loves, in the sense that all your love for craft, all your love, what do you do? So let's just talk about, let's say, okay, one work of mine, Silence Blood Wedding. I've spoken about it a lot, but the word silence is a very important thing in this work, because what happens when something dies? It's just that all conversation stops. You cannot talk to that person again, you know? So apart from the disappearance of the body as a material fact, what happens is that there is no conversation possible. It's the finality of the fact that nothing, now you can't talk to a person, you know? So so then silence in the title of the work is a very important way in which I understand actually the phenomena of death. So death is not just the missing body, but it's the missing, it's the complete silence that surrounds that body. And as I have said many, many times, that it's related to two factors in my life. My father being diagnosed with a very virulent form of cancer, in which it was said that he would not, that it was only 6 months, and that's the maximum, and him being a doctor. And I was at home, and I think we were all like shocked, because my father was a very healthy person. No smoking, no drinking, playing tennis, very regulated food habits. So it was a real shock to all of us, and we, as a family, we were in deep depression when this news came to us. And in that frame of mind, I asked my mother, where is the, you know, the bones that my younger brother, who was studying medicine, where are those bones? And she said, probably in the storeroom, just search it, possibly it's in a sack somewhere. So I went and I searched in the storeroom and I found this sack of bones. And I had never even imagined prior to this incident that I, that can ever be sculptural material. I mean, I had no, you know, nothing at all actually prepared me. But this is what I mean to say, that a crisis can completely catapult you into another space, another totally. So as I said, I got the sack of bones and I started working with each bone as a sculptural material. And I was absolutely astounded by its sculptural qualities as well as everything else. So these are the kind of strange complexities when you make work, you know, as an artist and as a sculptor. On the one hand, you're addressing a subject which is, but on the other hand, at the same time, you're also enjoying and appreciating its formal qualities, its sculptural qualities. All these things happen simultaneously. It's a strange mix. And I guess that's the strange space from which works happen, at least some works in my case. And as I've always said, some things can never happen again. You know, it's just a one-off thing because of the extreme emotional, psychic pressure or whatever condition that you find yourself in. So these are not things that have any kind of, you know, formula or anything that can be repeated. So in that sense, this is such a one-off work. And the very uncanny thing about it is that while I was preparing the bones with formaldehyde and all those materials, I was really deeply depressed. And the minute I started covering them with velvet and embroidering each little piece, I just found that I was actually regaining a great sense of life and a great sense. So basically the work, I've always said, it's actually working step by step against this fact of death, you know. So it's just negating the, saying that, you know, I don't accept it, you know. I want life, I want beauty, I want all these things. And so each one of them is constructed as a kind of a haiku poem towards life, basically.
And actually, you have to continue on the theme.
Yeah, in fact, picking up from where Anita left, I mean, she spoke so passionately about, you know, that moment of loss. And I think for me, this particular work is also very sort of outside the register of my usual work, even though now as I look back, a lot of my work does have this sense of the web. I mean, the word textile also has these close associations with the word textum, which is a Greek word for also the web. And in that sense, a lot of the work that I make has to do with the sense of weaving or of layering and this kind of creation of a fabric. But the piece that is in this exhibition called Walls of the Womb was really a work that I made when I sort of, you know, was a young mother. I was constantly going back to my early childhood years, having come full circle with my own experience with motherhood. And so much of early motherhood is about nurturing, nourishing, and I was going back to these closed wardrobes where my, you know, I lost my mother when I was really young as a little girl, and all the things she left behind remained stacked in wardrobes for nearly 30 years, and I was bringing them out and sort of, you know, I'd sort of built my relationship with her through these, whether they were photographs or her personal belongings, and amongst which were her handwritten recipe books, of which I had very vivid memories of her making me Indian sweets, and I decided to translate these recipes. Of course, there was one thing was that I wanted to reinforce her heavy silks that remained stacked, but at the same time, I didn't want to bring them out in the public domain, and I decided to then cut fabric in the length of a sari and translate these recipes into Braille, where I wanted the viewer to face the kind of inaccessibility to the text, much like my own relationship with her, which was sort of built through inscrutable fragments of memory. And I mean, I think a lot of other things that sort of go within the making of the work was about the inadequacies of language, of denied access, of really. So I made the piece through the process of tie and dye, where each dot was first drawn, and then I worked with craftspeople in Gujarat, you know, the Khatri families that work with tie and dye to form these scrolls. And I think I won't go on too long because we can return to a lot of the other things in the work and in the making, and that how some of these crafts only continue to, you know, across borders, whether they're in Karachi or in Kutch here, and other works that then come from this. But like Anita said, I mean, sometimes it's not that I've, you know, returned now after nearly 12 years or after 10 years, I returned to working with the same fabrics, but and in the same format, using Braille to create the tie and dye. But yeah, and there are many other things that we can speak about: memory, loss, and yeah, the web of relationships. And
sure. Paula, if you can come to you, and you know, if you can share some of your experiences, and you know, the process that involves your thoughts and ideas. Yeah.
Thank you, Arshia. So it's interesting that Reena talks about her mother. So I think I laid claim to working with textile, and particularly the Nokshi Katha, because at one point I decided that it was my birthright to do so. I learned to embroider from my mother and my grandmother, and who were both expert seamstresses, and my grandmother came from Khulna in Bangladesh, where they make a very special kind of katha, which is reversible. It works both ways. And and you know, when I was 40 years old, I made my first trip to Bangladesh, which is where we come from. And that's where I discovered the Nokshi Katha, which by nature is very different from the katha that that made its way across the border. And the Nokshi Katha is essentially, you know, it's a narrative medium. And the katha, for those of you who know the textile, is traditionally made on found fabric. It's not traditionally, I mean, it's not made a new textile. It is quilting of old cotton or silk textiles. And so what was actually, and you know, so the Nokshi Katha was essentially made by the women of the household on found textile, and the Nokshi Katha typically has not repeat patterns, but a large part of it, apart from borders is constituted of running patterns. So essentially, it is like a narrative field on which the the embroiderer is playing out her life or whatever her concerns, her anxieties, her whatever's going on in her life or the lives of her children and so on. So essentially, it is a Nokshikatha is like this vast narrative field. And that's what deeply attracted me to it. And so in this particular body of work, which was called Rivers of Blood, I started to use the Nokshikatha myself, and I'm trained as a printmaker. So initially I started to simulate the run stitch of the katha on my etching plates. And of course, drawing on the etching plate is a deeply meditative exercise. And, Anita talked about the meditative nature of embroidery and how therapeutic it is. So at one point I started actually embroidering myself rather than, simulating the run stitch on the etching plate. I started to use the needle like a drawing tool on found fabric, and most of the fabrics that I used in this body of work actually have histories of their own. For example, the work that is here, my father was an army officer, and that is his army shirt that I pulled out of some musty army trunk and embroidered, and even in the woman's garment, the apron in the front of the garment is actually a piece that was embroidered by my mother and my grandmother together, and I sort of absorbed it into the work and added to it. So it was all of these things that led me to working with this medium, with the material. The making and the material itself are sort of, they're metaphoric in the way I sort of adopted using it.
So, Dr. Jain, if you'd like to come in, and then if I can invite Shakuntala Kulkarni and also the Bodhi project, which so much kind of speaks about stitching and then your current body of work. Dr. Jain?
I think when you talk about Nokshikatha, because we talked about women and their engagement, actually speaking, almost all women's textile traditions are domestic in nature, whereas other textile, like cooking, domestic, so women are doing, but otherwise it is done by men. Coming to what you said, one important aspect of that would be that Nokshikathas were made by putting layers upon layer old. These were done by the poorest of the poor, and putting several layers of old saris, then they were putting in white thread on white millions of stitches to prepare a ground which had such texture, this unbelievable beauty, but no cost. And then the Bengali saris, which had borders either in red or black or blue, these women didn't even have money to buy thread from the market or need to buy thread in the market, so they used to pull out those threads. And these threads, when they used, these were old sari threads, and therefore, and they were, that time earlier, they were natural dyes, so indigo and madder and things. So the colors had become very muted, and these kanthas of that period, they provided that narrative field, what you said. And one more point about this narrative field in Bengal, and only in Bengal it happened, not in Kutch and elsewhere, is that in Bengal it happened, in Bengali paintings also, and every that this field, what you said, narrative, was open to imbibe new influences. So you will find in Nakshikatha, you will find fork and knife, nutcrackers, sometimes small airplane, or motor car, or lots of things already that time, they were just simply open to their contemporaneity. Even British textbook illustrations were often embroidered into Katha. And this openness of narrative is very important. Besides that labor, what I'm talking about, that they should, you must have seen, you see today what they make in saris and all is not layered. But that texture to create, the amount of engagement of the woman that is so amazing, and then this subdued thing that come, I think I just wanted to add to what you said.
Hello. Hi. There are two things I wasn't prepared for the Godrej now that you mentioned. I'm just going to, yes, I know. Yeah, yes. So I had done quilts, Godrej, with painted on each little piece and joined them and worked with a domestic person who, you know, they normally do Godrej, and my grandmother made Godrej for us and my kids, and now my grandchildren are using them. So there is a whole collection from 2-3 generations about Godrej. I find that very important, and fabric was, especially when I got my, I mean, when I had my children, material became very important for me. Till then, I don't think I really bothered about it, you know, wrapping them, folding them. It became very important for me, and the Godrej project came up in 1998. Now, I've used material in different ways, but the work that is here, the cane work, is completely different kind of a material what I use for the dresses. Now, like Anita said, something triggered off in your life. Same thing. I was walking on the streets and the tar fell on me and I burnt part of my hair and eyebrows, and I really wondered how safely you can walk on the streets of Bombay, and the idea of protection came at that point. But it didn't remain there, because I was also, you know, like I was going to SNDT regularly to read their, you know, like in their files, the rapes, atrocities on women. That was what used to call me. At that time, I used to study that. And when I read 6 months old type, nowadays we read all kinds of things, but this is way back in 2006-04. I read that in a small piece. I was really upset, and I said, protection is fine, but I've got to do something about the female body, and that's how this project came up, protecting the female body from violation in public and private spaces. This is what I started thinking about. Then how do I do it? I hadn't really done sculpture. I basically did painting and drawing and insulation. So I tried different materials and almost gave up till I saw my own cane curtain in front of me, and I said, why don't I try this? So just as an experiment, I called a person who works with cane, repairing chairs, and we worked together. I'd never done it, he had never done it, so we both sat together trying to work out, and it was a very organic experiment because both of us had to really innovate something. And from that came about because I've been fascinated by the armor. And it is very male, basically worn by the male body. But here, I was talking of the female body, so the cane, which looks very delicate, fragile, actually it's a creeper, and it's a very strong creeper. And you can bend it and twist it and turn it when you heat it, and it worked for me. And the monochromatic color also worked, and I decided to use it. And when I actually joined the joineries and the cane thread weaves, kind of created a translucent feel, like a curtain, where it broke the gaze also. It helped to go. So that, you know, it was like protecting the female body. It worked for me, and this is how I did. But then female body means I thought, how do I do that? And then I thought of dresses, because we all love to dress up. We like to dress up well. So the beautiful dresses and planning those dresses came up. And as you talk of the memories, you know, I'm fascinated by these films. So the Bollywood hairstyles or the colonial films that we've seen, like Anne of the Thousand Days or Gone with the Wind. So those kind of dresses, then Apna Utsav of the 80s, I don't know how many people remember here in Bombay that took place. So those folk dances, where Rajasthani skirts and, you know, like different kinds of dresses came up. So my work is not pertaining to any particular culture or history. It's mixed and matched, because the headgear could be Egyptian or Roman, and the skirt is Ghagra, you know, it's just kind of, and I believe in blurring the borders like this about cultures and religious things and, you know, histories. So that's how it came about. So it is about diving into my memory archives and using this material for that purpose. I mean, we can talk more about this, but I've taken more time.
So your use for material, especially the sensorial, the textures, and so your integration of that in your work? So.
I came to textile, I think it was about 2005, and I would say I've kind of grown up with this love for fabric, and because my mother and grandmother, you know, in the pre-television days, they were constantly embroidering, you know, as if, you know, even petticoats under their saris were like really ornate and really worked upon. And I was always fascinated by this. And somehow I was a hoarder, you know, so I would have fabric clippings and, you know, even as a collagist in college, I would collect all kinds of things, which included scraps of fabric, which were always mixed, you know. It wasn't about, say, beautiful silk or, you know, wonderful handloom, which I liked to wear, but it was often about, you know, upholstery fabrics, which are, sometimes they are absolutely ugly and coarse, and but they have a certain intimacy. It's something you grow up sitting on, you know, a chair, an old chair, or, so for me, it was like a memory bank, probably. And later, in about, I think it was 2004, when I was invited to do this, it was a public work where I was to paint the marriage of Shiva Parvati. Rajiv Sethi invited us. And so because it was a marriage subject, I thought of, finally I came to painting on a mattress. You know, so I did this, what I would call a double bed with the images of Shiva and Parvati. And it was on a mattress, and you know, somehow for me it became like a pregnant painting, you know, and I really enjoyed it very much, painting on this upholstery fabric. And most important for me was that the sensation of, you know, being a figurative painter. I was painting this head, and suddenly the skin had all these, the textures, the flowers, and you know, everything that was embossed in that fabric became the skin of my faces. And that was a fantastic experience, and I thought I could, you know, work with this. Also, at that time, I was doing a lot of work which had to do with skin, and working with my own, my skin disorder, and my vitiligo. And I thought that I could explore this idea of pattern on fabric and paint on textured fabric, and I could push it more. So that's how it started. And then after that, I think it was a surface, it was also an intimate presence, something you wear, something you live with as furniture. And also thinking of Rauschenberg, you know, he was a big hero for me, Robert Rauschenberg. And then the whole that whole spread of fabric and what it can do, you know, the visual appeal of pattern and fabric. And so I thought I was, I kind of wanted to work more with it. And what you see here upstairs is, I think, it's kind of a continuation of those themes. And what was here, I think very important for me, was a grid. I think it was like, for me, the compartments, sort of an urban grid, and also a whole becomes parts. And then you can explore it as bits of drawing or bits of an image, you know, sort of making a large hole, but again breaking it up, and all that.
Sure. Thank you so much. Pushpa.
You know, when Pooja Vaish wrote to me and she said she wanted me in the show about textiles, I said that my work has nothing to do with textiles, why are you including me? But she said, no, we're looking at it in a broader way in terms of also in terms of costume and clothing and so on and so forth. So what, I mean, I've been actually since the mid-90s, I've been working with this idea of masquerade. And I believe that the Indian nation itself is a masquerade, and which is sort of displayed in the, as Dr. Jain has written, in these Republic Day parades and so on. So I grew up, like, my mother was an amateur, actress, and so she would organize these Brides of India and, Costumes of India pageants. So all the photographs in our house are about these, all of us in strange costumes, either mythological or these, so this whole thing of the nation as a, I don't know where it came from, because I have a feeling it has some sort of Victorian roots, because I know there were these kind of costume parties, which at least the aristocracy used to have, and they were very, very elaborate, and also they involved photography, because apparently in one part of the party, there would be this kind of painted backdrop, and the guests would stand there one by one, and there would be this photographer with this enormous field camera who would be photographing the guests. But somehow it sort of crept into this whole, all our national festivities and definitions in some way, So I remember even the Illustrated Weekly of India, and it's extremely ethnographic. I think, who was the editor then, I forget, before Preetish Nandi? Kushwant Singh. Kushwant Singh used to have this series on which each issue was on some community, and the Iyengars or something like that, and then something, whatever. So, so in a sense, the work over here, I shot them, this is an interesting story actually, because I shot them in Bombay, in this place called the India Photo Studio, which was run by Mr. J.H. Tucker, who's now gone. But he actually came from, I think, Lahore, and he started this, at first actually he went to Bangalore, he couldn't succeed over there, so he came to Bombay, and then he put up this studio in Dadar, which was on the same road as several of the film studios. So he got a job as this young photographer shooting film stills. So in fact, he shot all these very beautiful portraits of the stars of the day, particularly of the 1950s and 60s. And there's still the legendary portraits of these, Nargis, Meena Kumari, Dilip Kumar, and so on. In fact, Ram Rahman had, he got to know him through me, but he had this big show of his work in Bhadaji Lad, I think a year or two ago. So actually I worked with him, and that was during the Open Circle workshop, which Tushar and Sharmila had invited me for. That's how I first met them actually. So I was wondering what to do, and some guy who was a volunteer said, pardon? Shirke, yeah, I can't remember him. Yeah, he said like, there's an interesting photo studio, I'll take you there and all that. And this man was very friendly. And I didn't know what, I just went to take some portraits of myself. Then I found all these wonderful pictures, these sepia-toned photographs of all these stars all over the place. And it was a kind of Art Deco style studio. So basically, I did the initial work then and developed it later, about a year later. And there are two sets. One is called Triptych, which has these three communities, major communities, Hindu, Muslim, Christian. So I'm sort of playing on this whole thing of the masquerade, the costume as masquerade. You cannot see these women's faces, all three of them. So, but you identify them by their costumes. So what amuses me that even today, if I wear a dress, for instance, somebody will ask me, are you Christian? And if I wear a salwar kameez, are you Muslim? And if I wear a sari or something, are you Hindu, So it's so firmly identified, the kind of, not only that, but the accessories and so on. So it's like we're constantly masquerading as, for example, if I go for a wedding wearing a sari and I do not wear a kumkum, about 20 relatives will come up to me and said, why aren't you wearing this kumkum, for instance, So it's all this kind of thing. And the other, so in a sense, the titles also, with the titles as well, I'm playing with these ethnographic names, because it's spelt in this very British colonial way, portrait of a Hindu, H-I-N-D-O-O, Mohammedan woman, and so on. So there's the kind of ethnographic stereotypes, and then I developed this other series, which is based on the Navarasa. So one of the things I'm interested in is going back and forth. And of course, like if you want to talk about the archive, my work is very much about the archive, but I call it the pseudo archive because it's like everything is the archive, you know. I mean, usually an archive is something that is valuable or sensible or logical and which is collected for a purpose, but actually in life you just absorb all kinds of strange things. And another sort of theory about it is that somebody called it, two scholars called it cultural memory. So I'm very interested in the whole notion of cultural memory. And that could be like, for example, 1970s Rajkumar film. I could have seen the Kannada actor Rajkumar, and I remember a costume from his film of a nightclub dancer, and I use it in the 90s, for example, as a character in my work. So that's also part of my archive, or it could be my art historical studies and so on. So of course, the Navarasa is something we studied in art history, and this is a modern version. And I guess again, like, I've taken different kinds of references. Some of them are references from photo studios. Some things I've cooked up, and some things are actually film references. And some things are also references from Thakur's own work, two or three of them. So, and he very interestingly used this, Hollywood glamour style lighting and photography, which came from the expressionist style. So you use very strong sort of shadows and light. And another thing very interesting about him is that he actually uses a narrative in his work, you know, which I've not really seen, because I've seen some Western studios using the Hollywood glamour style portrait photography, and that is basically lighting up the face in a certain kind of way to glamorize it. But here he uses these, film noir kind of bars and shadows on the wall and all that. So I used elements of his style with that.
Okay, friends, just one little correction. It was both Pooja and myself who wrote to you.
Oh,
and just to ensure that you don't think that I did not invite you to the show, and it was very much me who placed your work where it is in the show. So just to make that clarification, so that you don't have any misunderstandings. But just also to come to and to talk about what Arshay was talking about, and look at the materiality and the in terms of craft and process. It's one of the things that both of us, when we began talking about the show, I was very concerned about, and we had a long discussion about it, because at one point we were thinking also of including textiles and how could we include weavers. And I think that's been a question for us, and it's something I know that Dr. Jain has been working on for many years. That's been a question for us because of the nature of our museum. So what you see here are objects. So what is this divide between art and craft? And then different kinds of craft. Folk craft didn't make it into this museum because this was a museum of decorative arts, of the higher, the finer decorative arts, not the folk arts. So unlike Dr. Jain's museum in Delhi, where you would see quite a lot of what was called tribal, and I have real problems with that word tribal, with tribal culture, or we can call it indigenous culture, that's not reflected in this museum. So, and it's my own practice in terms, I went to the JJ School of Art, and I studied textile design, and I studied weaving and tie and dye. We had the choice of either printmaking and studying dyeing and weaving. And I went to become an artist. And here I was working with a certain skill, and I always thought of myself as being an artist, that I was learning a skill, and a lot of the weaving that I did and a lot of the works that I produced were very contemporary. So this binaries that exist, and that's what I said at the beginning of our seminar, that the idea is to question these binaries, to really to unpack them in a sense and say, are these constructed epistemologies that we have just bought into? Do they really hold a certain validity? Are the structures by which we have imposed these definitions and these categories and this the idea that has come to us from the Enlightenment of documenting, of science, of segmenting, of categorizing these taxonomies, should we not be questioning them and trying to they're very difficult in terms of, so when in the end we thought about whether we should include weavers, you know, if you've seen Martan Singh's show in Delhi, and Mayank Man Singh Kaul had done a show in Jaipur. So are those also not works of contemporary artists? So I think these are some of the questions that we hoped that in this seminar and in this discussion, and these questions came up earlier when we were just talking with the artist, that how do they look at these collaborations? Because many of them, Sharmila, for example, and many of the others, Reena, the others are collaborating with artists, and how do you position that kind of a collaboration as well? I think these are knotty issues, but I do think that we need to address them, and maybe Pooja would like to talk about them, and Dr. Jain perhaps can shed some light because he spent his whole life talking about these, dealing with these issues.
I think I've said all what I had to say this afternoon. this dichotomy will remain in a way that, you know, but at the same time, I think it breaks in something what has happened now, that, you know, we do not, craft just for marketing and making things this way different. Then when it is brought into another framework like what these works that are being done, and that is where I think a meeting point starts more. I think there is an intellectual dimension to that, and that I think without that we can't just put both, say, craft and art, and, you know, it's an old debate. What I feel is that there is something else which is important, you know, and where it's not that let me give an example, because what I'm saying is not, you, who said you worked in Kutch with block printers? I was working in the same workshop most probably earlier, and the perceptions are very interesting. You know, when they do natural dye with red madder, some of you are working with textiles would know, and some of you would know, that when you work with madder dye, you have to modern the cloth. So you put alum in it or any other stuff, sar stuff, and dip the cloth in that. Some perception that I came across in this was that I was working in the most probably same workshop, but where you work, perhaps the father of that person who came from Pakistan into India several generations ago. So there was an American anthropologist who came with me to Kutch, and I like to go to Kutch and work with block printers and things those years. So I went to one workshop. My main role was to interpret for the person, and the person was writing down all the time how much to what. So he was preparing modern, and this modern in a bucket. You know, he was normal water. And then he would take alum like this and throw in the water and stir it. So this lady asked me, anthropologist, that she wanted to make a note, documentation. So saying, can you ask this person how much alum to how much water? So I asked the man, I said, she's asking how much alum to how much water. So he said, he just laughed and said, do you see any scale in my hand, or, you know, I'm just, so she reframed the question. Because you see, when the modern is strong, then you get very deep red, you know, when you use red dye, natural dye. And if you put something little and you dip your cloth in that and dye, it will become pinkish. So if you want deep red, right up to almost brown, you need to put more alum. So she said, okay, but how does he know what shade of red will he get when he puts something like this? so she wanted to say that if you put 50 grams or 200 grams or something, then it would be, you know, known that you will get this shade of red. So he laughed and said, yeah, now you have framed the question rightly. And then what he did was he just stirred the solution, took it like this, and put it on his tongue. And then he said that as I savor the solution on my tongue, I visualize the shade of red that I will get. You know, these are totally different perceptions, you know, they vary. And I think a lot of then he said further that when we eat our food, we know exactly if the salt is less or sugar is too much in your tea. Then he said that a son of a block printer will not get a girl in marriage unless he knows this, because otherwise he would starve. Because, you know, so I'm saying that there are many such things that I came across. So when we talk about intellect and perception issues, you know, these merge at some point. And I think when contemporary artists with contemporary awareness are dealing with craft, is a point where such subtleties may coincide, you know, in a different way, though, of course. But I think this is one example I can give in which I can answer what you said about.
Yeah, hi. How are we doing for time?
Yeah, I think we should take questions.
Okay.
And we can probably invite the other artists also.
So, would everybody like to come up front and the other panel as well? Abhay?
Or, yeah, there is very little space. But I think what you can do is you can, they're sitting in the front.
The artists are sitting here. Abhay is sitting here. And if you just, we could just bring you in. Come. Thode kursiyan liya. Huh? You could, if you have a question to a particular artist, you could just address it to them. And they are with us here. As well, yeah.
So one of the things that really came through was, you know, often, although one thinks that working with textile of craft and as a form and as a medium, the resilience, the kind of catharsis, and, you know, in a way, the kind of healing that maybe some of the works kind of provided for different things over here is, it's kind of, something which is maybe very personal to a female space and body. And one of the things that I wanted to ask is, in terms of the history of textiles and crafts, and I just wondered, Dr. Jain, in terms of the precedent, were women karigars, you know, I mean, of course, they were in the domestic. But in terms of, you know, making works or crafts, and what was the position, you know, in terms of the last, like, 200 years? Were they allowed? Were they visible at all?
I mean, as I said, that all domestic textiles, embroidery, etc., which were at a different quality. So if you take Kutch again, for example, now, if you take the embroidery of Kutch, which was primarily done by women, as dowries. So it was done as dowries for their daughters and things. So the purpose for which it was done, and therefore the engagement that happened, was very different than men's textiles, which are meant for marketing. So this, I think, is a major difference, you know, and you can see that difference in the quality of work that is produced.
Thank you.
So we've had a very rich afternoon. I'm sure all of you have questions that you, something must have provoked you, or something that intrigued you.
This question of ideology underlying artistic output or even the so-called craft output. I've always been, a point of view, I like to chase that idea. And I wanted to know from any artist, all the artists here, if this question ever bothered them, you know, or does just the artistic impulse, I mean, the sheer aesthetics and line, form, color, does that just take over the ideological position that you have? In many people, you can see it. I mean, you can see it and see a clear social political position in Archana Hande, where are you? You can see it, and I mean, you can see it in all. In a muted way or in a very open way. And but in a person like Nilima, where she's so humbly just describing her, let's say her homage to labor, but there's so many other reverberations that come from her work, which is the poetic, the Sufi idea, the idea of prayer, devotion, and the idea of a guru teaching a person. So were there these dilemmas of projecting one's point of view and having it shown through your work? Or did you suppress it totally? Or did you have this ambivalent position that it'll maybe come on its own?
I'd like to respond to this, that I mean, if the work can acquire as many layers, you know, the more successful and more the deeper its impact, not only for or the happiness for the artist as well as for the viewer. For example, if it can have all these aspects, a politics, but not necessarily only a politics, also aesthetics, also. So as many layers if it can work with, the more fine, it can be for, I think, mutually for, not only for oneself as an artist, but also for the audience. So this is the way I kind of, so not all works can, you know, reach that level, but some works do, and I think that's the, sometimes some things are quite amazing when that happens.
So this to and fro between your position and the aesthetics, or they're just not separated anyway?
No,
it's not a to and fro, it's merged.
It gets merged, yeah, and that's the, yeah.
Anyone?
Yeah, yeah. I think, I mean, as an artist, you're constantly working with both ideas and form, and oftentimes the biggest challenge is to be able to bring the form that's most appropriate. I mean, in that sense, I would say that a lot of what we spoke about, I mean, you're constantly developing new skills, even crafts within the work of how do you craft an idea. And I mean, if I have to think of my own practice, it was like a decade and a half of working with the stamps, which again form a highly labored, and the ideas they communicate, whether they're Mason marks trying to foreground those histories of labor, or you're trying to, through a whole range of works that I've made, using the electric cable, one that's both a transmitter of energy exchange as communication cable, something that links and connects us, but also then morphs into barbed wires, fences that are holding these sort of inherent contradictions of being both a conduit carrier and a barrier at the same time. And then that forms a kind of web work, a whole woven tapestry, which, I've done a whole series of drawings, wall drawings essentially, that are made using the line as a beginning. But it again forms a map, which is a complex map, tracing flows and movements of migrants historically, and as a sound component. But in various works, it works differently. So for instance, I mean, just to give you quick examples, a piece that I'm currently, that's going to the Havana Biennale is a range of 12 scrolls, 14 scrolls that are made using the process of tie and dye, but these are preambles of constitutions which are of countries that are either politically partitioned or in conflict, but they, you know, you're looking at sort of founding principles, values that sort of are embedded in these, in the constitutions, but the common words are in Braille, where, I mean, sort of metaphors of having lost sight or of having, you know. So there are various layers of how one, again, the tactility of the Braille, one that is neither accessed by those who are sighted nor by those who are blind, because you cannot really feel it and read it, so the illegibility factor. And so you try and use metaphors and use mediums in a way that carry those metaphors as well, but of course.
Just to continue this, actually, I mean, and talk about textile and fabric, it was very central to the women's movement, feminist art, actually, in the 60s. Because that's when, I mean, there was this whole debate about male art and female art, and then the female art was always considered a craft, like quilting and weaving and macrame and all that, for instance. Actually, feminist artists specifically started working in these forms. So the material itself can be, ideology. And later on, I find, like, for example, Sheila Gowda using cow dung. It's a symbol for the subaltern, you know. Or for example, Chris O'Feely is using elephant dung. It's also a symbol for race and the subaltern. So that itself is an embedded sort of ideology in the practice. And in fact, we were just talking about Dilu's work, you know, Mrinalini Mukherjee's work, that she was international far before, like, anyone else in India. And then she was actually connecting to this whole 70s, worldwide feminist thing of using weaving. But no one over here actually saw it as that, like, you know. No one saw it as feminist work. And she was actually using those, images of very sexual and organic sort of earth imagery, which is also very kind of, people are using at that point. Sorry.
Why is she not in this showroom?
Couldn't get the role. That's right. Sorry, I was just thinking of something else.
As a response to your question, I think it becomes second nature when you claim to be a political artist. When you claim a political artist, an artist whose work comes from the kind of politics that they believe in. Even when you talk of collaboration. My work cannot be complete without Raju. So the processes of how you work is an indicative of what a collaboration is. And then, of course, there is aesthetics. I cannot not have aesthetics in my work. But so does Raju. The other reason is, why do you choose a particular kind of craftsperson? I went to Chedamangala, but before that I had gone to almost 5 or 6 other cooperatives in that area. This one was particularly interesting for me because this was a cooperative which was formed only by women. So when the men folks said that they don't want to use their looms anymore and the looms were lying in the house, it was the women who formed the cooperative. And so there are almost 120 looms which are run by women. Raju, however, is the master craftsman. It's always a patriarchal society. They have to get people either like Raju, who is, you know, then teaching them how to weave, because they would only make thread. Even when I worked with the Devaniya community in Bolangi, the women did all the sort of, you know, base work. But it was always the man who is the weaver. So, I mean, these are things that one takes into account when one chooses a particular form. So, I hope that answers.
Just a quick question.
question to Tasni and Pooja in terms of the selection and thinking about the curation of the show. Be interesting. I mean, I'm sure that you did look at a whole lot of. So sorry.
No, it's okay. It's just, I just wanted to, and also about the material that you choose. You know, sometimes there is there's another layer. You know, a political layer, which is sometimes it's not even intentional. But for instance, while choosing fabric for my work, I've often come across. I live in Ghatkopar, Bombay suburb. And I try to choose material which is used, say, locally in the neighborhood for sofas or something. And I find that a lot of it is imported from Turkey. In fact, most of it. And I was surprised. And as again, say, silk or handloom, which was more expensive, khadi fabric to clothe a sofa is more expensive than this Turkish fabric. So it's you come across surprising truths, you know, which is. And then, you know, it's like I'm looking at Persian miniatures or I'm looking at a certain kind of, say, Turkish imagery. I'm reading Orhan Pamuk. And then I'm surprised that this is where it's coming from, you know. So I try to make these connections. It's all in my head. And it's funny, you know, then the aesthetic choice becomes some sort of a discovery of global trade or things like that, you know, which is also part of it.
The fact that, of course, these artists are using textile, but be interesting to kind of understand why you selected them and, you know, the process of that.
We looked at many artists. We made a list of all the artists, including Mrinalini, but she's having a show at the Met Broya, and so the works were not available. And there were other artists who we wanted to include, and it was very difficult. And then we had a constraint of space as well. So it was where and how would the narrative flow? You know, so we looked at different artists who addressed different issues. For example, issues of identity that you see, issues of process, materiality, colonial, the juxtaposition of archive that you see upstairs, and then the idea of body, the idea of, you know, the notion of femininity that goes with it, and questioning the identity, you know, the juxtaposition of Pushpa's work with Anju's, which we took a lot of time struggling with that and got it right, I think. Anita's work. And Anju's putting Anju's up with. There was another work of Anju's that we wanted very much to include, but we were very anxious because we get such large crowds. So all the issues that you see, the way we've broken it down as well, and there is a very definite narrative through the whole show. It's not just placed anywhere. It's very clearly works that speak to each other as well.
I think when we started thinking of textile, there were like Ms. Mehta said, there were a lot of things that came up, you know, and the first things that came up were, of course, craft and art and, you know, the decorative arts and gender and all of these things. But then I think what finally the show does and how we pick the artists was to actually keep it to talk about other things through textile, of all the things that textile touches, you know. So that was the decisions that we made. That's why there are artists who thought they initially that they were could not be, like, why are we even talking to them, or they're not part, could not be part of the show. But I think that what it does is that, you know, these sort of binding, like craft and art, to sort of open it out and find like a different way of looking at things. Because actually what the show was doing is not like positing one thing against the other, you know. So it was kind of putting together all these different, really like stories actually. You know, it's stories, it's like personal stories, it's national like stories of actual people, of textile, of migration, of trade, of national history, you know. So it's all these things that textile touches, actually. So it's wrong to say that it's artists working with textile. And I also think that, of course, Dr. Jain had very beautifully given us this whole history. And I think what is very important is also the process. Like, a lot of these things are procedural. You know, there's a thing of repetition, or like Nilima was saying about, you know, craft traditions that are still living. These are part of our, you know, so how do we understand terms like what is traditional, what is modern, contemporary, you know, those kind of things, and to find things that actually exist within, like, interstices of these, you know, broad sort of areas. So I think that's what we were looking at, and then we did, like Ms. Mehta said, make a large list, you know, we discussed it, we were trying to see, and then I think what we finally did was what also speaks, of course, to our collection, which is why we brought out a lot of our collection, including the textile, you know, workers, which find so much resonance with, say, even Nilima's work, where she has also referred to the British documents, or if you see Pushpamala's work, you know, it's actually relates to, like, a whole clay model collection is actually kind of like a sartorial history in a way, you know. So there's so much in the museum that talks about all of these things, and I think the way that the works, the contemporary artworks work with our historical collection sort of brings up all these debates, and, you know, that's why we are all here now.
Are there any other questions? Yeah, there's one at the back.
Hello, ma'am. Hello, sir.
Okay, so, wait, hold it to you.
Is it? Yeah. So I recently graduated from NIFT Mumbai, and after 4 years of creating a love and respect for the handloom and the handicraft sector, I come back to my city, and then I meet the millennials and the other my generation, and I speak to them about it, and I see this huge difference which lies between me and them now. Because I look at all of these things in a very different perspective than them. And I see this big bridge which needs, I don't know, it needs kind of a connection. So I wanted to know what you all would have, like, a message to us, at least the ones who have been studying about it, to the next generation. Because when if I wear a block printed thing, they'll think it's very simple. So the entire knowledge, or, you know, the entire work that goes behind is very tough to explain. And I think the mega brands which come, they don't prefer wearing handlooms, and they are like, no, we'll wear the brand. So as a designer, or maybe as a student of a college, I don't know how to bring a message to them, or maybe bridge this.
I think you'll have to look at our caste system and you'll understand a lot. Yeah? It's just something that we need to understand. And then we'll understand the difference between the craftsman, the artist, metropolitan lives, villages, you'll understand it all. So just a little bit of sociology and then it comes to you.
I don't want to, but I'm forced to.
I think we have a beautiful heritage. If you start looking at it, I think it's great fun to delve into that. There's so much to learn from. I'm also not really against the new brands which are coming, you know. I think both can coexist is what I feel. Because I don't think we can shun the change which is happening.
My only thing is that people are not getting aware of it.
I think there will be.
Oh. There might be ways.
So I have actually taught at NIFT in Kolkata for about 5 years of my life. And that's where my interest in textiles, costume, body, all of this actually originates. You know, my student, I moved on to teach at university and teach printmaking, but my NIFT students are the ones I hold closest to my heart, to be very frank with you. So if I may say so, there are today a host of designers who work in very niche spaces, and they work with the indigenous textile and craft and art traditions of our country. And they have carved a space for themselves. And you know, there are the mega brands, and you know, there are the vast multitudes of India to whom the mega brands cater and supply clothes and textiles and upholstery and everything too. If you looked at Dr. Jain's presentation carefully, there was these, you know, these huge amounts of textile that was coming in from the mills, you know, for centuries, for such a long time. But our traditional textiles have certainly taken a beating, but they have not been eradicated and they have not died out. There is a renewed interest in them. As artists working in the medium, we work in even more niche spaces than designers do. But there is a whole host of interest. And if you're one of those young people who is inspired and interested in the textile traditions of India, you should stick with it. You should have faith. You will always find a section of niche people like yourself who will be your consumers. You should not lose heart. There's room for everybody.
I'm going to just ask Dr. Jain to give us a final comment, and then we'll close.
Manisha says that this is because I'm well dressed. You know what Roshan, you were saying, and all other students' comments and work have also shown that. You know, ideology and aesthetic, let me use that word for form as such, are not separable. You know, a very bad translation of the word aesthetics is science of beauty, and which would relate to form. But actually speaking, etymologically also, it's a medical term. It is like when you take anesthesia, you don't perceive. So aesthesia is perception. So if you go to by that, and then if you go to first that meaning of perception, then you go into feeling, then you go into other whole gamut of subjective things that happen. And then go from that subjectivity, the way you perceive society and take into you in your own time. And that is where what we call politics can enter into art. So I'm saying, and as Pushpa was saying, and others were saying, that the material, it's not that you take certain material and create a form and then put into that a political message. It's not so. It's the process itself, right from a found object. If I use this distillery bottle and I'm looking at it, and if I'm an artist and I certain associations come out of that for me, then I think that I could imbibe that and automatically this, because the very fact that I choose this found object or any other or craft or whatever craft, say if I see the labor or something, any such thoughts that come, they are internal, and the material becomes a kind of medium through which, so I don't think that that political or ideological is not something that is separable from the creating of the form or aesthetic itself. So aesthetic, in today's critical terminology of an art, is already inclusive of all the ideological and other things that go into the making of the art, for my feeling. And that is what I would look at the work of artists that is put up here, and large contemporary art practice, which is often said political, ideological. I think it's not like as if everyone is putting that kind of content inside political. It's a part of it. It's part of that thought process which needs an artist to make a work. and form and so you know this whole debate 19th century form content separation doesn't really work, and today it's becoming more and more wider. So I think that we could, if we look at work from that perspective, that thought, then I think this problem where it doesn't exist, I mean actually, would be sorted out.
Thank you to all the artists, and thank you Dr. Jain, thank you Abhay and Arshia. And friends, there is a walkthrough tomorrow with the artists at 4 o'clock. So please do come for that, because you'll be able to hear them speaking specifically about each work. I'm looking forward to seeing you and looking forward to seeing, please tell all your friends. It's part of the Mumbai Gallery Weekend. And thank you for being a wonderful audience. I hope you've enjoyed the afternoon.